Good morning.
Thank
you for being so intrepid and braving the elements. Hopefully we'll provide enough warmth, spiritual and otherwise, to cast away the cold and the snow. We have, this is Commitment Sunday, in case you don't know, so a great deal of the service is going to revolve around our commitment to the church and the reasons for it. We have two announcements to make. Teresa Jacobson is carrying on the spirit and the activities of her husband, Al Jacobson, who is a good friend to many of us in this congregation, and will be doing the work of signing the forms, the Amnesty International forms, after church. It's a wonderful activity, and I don't know where Al is, but if he can see us, he'd be very happy to. We also would like to make an announcement about the feedback forms. The staff, the people who run this church, don't know how they're doing unless you tell them. So please fill out the forms and deposit them in this lovely little wooden church model that's outside there somewhere. And the, let's see, and Lisa, you had an announcement you wanted to make?
Many of you receive in your mail every quarter the UU World magazine, and there's an article in the magazine this quarter on trans people and trans people in our faith tradition. There has been an apology issued by the UU World for that article, and there's also been a lot of conversation about centering marginalized people and how we can best do that as people of our faith. Later this week, Reverend Ann and I will be sending an email out to you with resources so that you can learn more about this issue and why it's important in our faith tradition to be welcoming to trans people. Thank you.
Now come to your favorite moment of the church where we greet each other. It might be a nice idea, if you run out of things to say, to ask the person next to you, what's the basis of their contribution to the church?
Thank you. There's a house we can build. Every room inside is filled with things from far away. Special things I can pile, each one that'll make you smile on a rainy day.
They can say it all sounds crazy. They can say I'm lost my mind. I don't care if they call us crazy. Run away to a world that we design. Cause every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me awake. I think of what the world could be, a vision of the one I see. A million dreams is all it's gonna take.
Thank you so much, Children's Choir, for your inspirational music. It was beautiful. Good morning. To worship means to consider that which has worth. And today we consider with gratitude the many gifts of this community, the opportunity to be affirmed in who we are and to offer that affirmation to others. The chance to stand up together to help remake the world in the ideal of justice. The freedom to choose one's path to truth and to learn from the travelogues of others. The space to expand one's own spirit and to reconnect after busy or humdrum weeks with the sustaining truths of one's lives. Regular reminders that we must see our world through the lens of love. And the aspiration to consider all life as precious. For if it is made of stardust, how can it not be wondrous? So this morning, let's welcome all these gifts with gratitude, for they have been paid for with many currencies. The blood of the martyrs who died so that we can be free in our religion. The sweat of those who persisted in justice's name against hostility and adversity. The tears of those who struggle to build better lives for those in this life. The questions of our children as they understand the world anew and offer their understanding to us as a fresh lens. The laughter and joy of those giddy with the embrace of community. The dollars and cents of those who gave what they could and then stretched a little more. The infinite small acts of service that make the parts greater than the whole, done by those who knew themselves in sympathy with our purpose. So today we consider with gratitude and humility what it means to pay forward what has been paid forward for us. And now with all of this, let us enter into worship with gladness in our hearts. I invite you to rise as you are able and willing and sing our first hymn, called As Partners in Service. You will find the music printed in your order of service, or you can just read the words with us.
Thank you. Please remain standing for the chalice lighting and the unison affirmation that'll follow it. We light this chalice to honor our work, to celebrate our community, and to bring hope and determination to our mission in the wider world. The unison affirmation. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with the divine.
Oh my God, a text wrong. I did it. So Higgins lived in this valley, and although it once had been filled with these beautiful flowers, It now was brown and dry, and there was nothing flowering, no lushness to it. Kind of would be like, you know, because I watch Moana like all the time now. It's all volcanic, nothing's growing. It's all taka. And Higgins had a dream that this valley could be once again just like it was, filled with flowers and chartreuse and vermilion, filled with just wonderful grasses and moss everywhere you looked, and it would all be healthy. But Higgins was just a drop. One drop cannot fill a valley. So Higgins had this dream that he would get everybody else to agree with him. Because even though he would just be a drop, if they all got together, then all the drops could become a lot of water, and they could water the valley, and grasses would grow, and flowers would grow again, and the trees would go tall again. And all the other drops are like, Higgins, man, it's not gonna work. You're just one drop. I'm just one drop. It's just like, man, like, give it up. So he did, and that's the end of the story. Sorry, I'm snot, but. So Higgins, though, he's like, I'm not gonna be deterred. You guys can all say no, but I think that we can make a difference. So Higgins went, and he found a bucket. And McKenna, since I lost my handheld, can you help me out here? So since I have the handheld, just need you to be my hands for a second. Thank you. So Higgins said, I'm going to the bucket. One water droplet in the bucket. And he sat in the bucket. Said, hey, everybody, I'm in the bucket. Anybody want to join me? One by one. One by one, the water droplets jumped in the bucket. I'm going with Higgins. I want in on this dream. What can we do? I want to get, hey, everybody, have you heard about Higgins' dream? Let's get into that bucket. Let's get in the bucket. Everybody in the bucket. So now they're all in the bucket and all the drops. McKenna, can you give that bucket a shake for me? You hear all those drops? You hear all of those drops in that bucket? And after they filled one bucket, more drops followed Higgins' dream, and they filled 5 buckets, 10 buckets, 100 buckets, 1,000 buckets, until they had enough buckets filled that they were able to spread water all through the valley. And now our buckets are full. So now that we have, all right, well, somebody's also pledging in this bucket too, apparently. McKenna. It's pretty good sleight of hand, though. I saw that, though. And so, you all know the moral of this story, that when we all put our drops into the bucket together, we can make beautiful, wonderful things happen. Thank you all for listening. This morning, we're gonna depart for the primary class after the anthem, because we have more singing from our children's choir.
closed my eyes, drew back the curtain to see for certain what I thought I knew far, far away. Someone was weeping, but the world was sleeping. Any dream will do.
I wore my coat
with golden lining, bright colors shining, wonderful and new. And in the east, the dawn was breaking, and the world was waking. Any dream will do. A crash of drums, a flash of light, my golden.
I'd like to invite you into a time of meditation and prayer, and after we have a moment of silence, you're invited to come to the rear of the sanctuary and light a candle that represents the joy or the sorrow that you carry on your own heart this morning. I would like to lift up the families of those who lost their loved ones on the flight out of Addis Ababa this morning. It's always tragic when a plane drops out of the sky like that, and my heart's with them today. Our prayer this morning is by my colleague Mark Bellatini. Please join me in prayer. Stars of twilight, the gray clouds only hide you. They do not steal you away. You still burn there on the dark mantle of infinity, regardless of how anything obscures you. You are neither impatient nor resentful. You are just there, burning bright, that I might grow as faithful. Dreams of my mind, nothing can take you away. Dreams of children at play, dreams of lovers holding hands in the streets, dreams of friends embracing warmly, dreams of families around the world laughing at supper, dreams of a good day's work and peaceful rest. You continue to warm me, even when the nightmare of war chills my heart. You are there, O dreams, shining, warming, regardless of how anything obscures you. You are neither invalidated nor discountable. You are just there, burning bright, that I might be illumined. Silence in my soul, you too are always there. hidden behind 1,000 sighs and 1,000 clamoring headlines. You often hide yourself under piles of snow. You strain yourself between bare branches. You hover over the stars of twilight and the dreams of my mind. But now, come out into the open, O silence, into this place and this hour, amid these people, that we might be comforted and set free for a time. Let us rest in the silence that we make together.
Our reading this Sunday is a poem called The Journey by contemporary American poet David White. Above the mountains, the geese turn into the light again, painting their black silhouettes on an open sky. Sometimes everything has to be inscribed across the heavens so you can find the one line already written inside you. Sometimes it takes a great sky to find that small, bright, and indescribable wedge of freedom in your own heart. Sometimes, with the bones of the black sticks left when the fire has gone out, someone has written something new in the ashes of your life. You are not leaving, you are arriving. Please rise, is that right? Yeah, and sing the hymn by Holly Near. The copy is in your order of service.
This winter, I had been reading a new-to-me author. Olivia Butler was a leading African-American writer of science fiction and was the early pillar of a subgenre known as Afrofuturism. The Parable of the Sower follows the story of Lauren Olamina, a young black girl who leads her people to a new community of hope and promise, and who discovers a new religion, which she calls Earthseed. Set in a dystopian future where global warming has wreaked havoc in people's lives, this book from the 1990s opens in 2024. Not so far away now, huh? Not such a distant possibility from my perspective. Butler extrapolated her vision of a near future dystopia from what she read in the news, forecasting what kind of collapse might result if the forces of late stage capitalism, climate change, mass incarceration, big pharma, gun violence, and the tech industry continue uninterrupted. This is not an easy read, let me tell you. It feels too close to the truth of today. But what I'm loving is the religion which Lauren discovers. She writes this foundational verse, which becomes scripture for her and for her companions. All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change. Lauren and her family scrape together their existence behind a locked gate, but she realized that someday she might need to leave the safety of home. And so she begins to collect seeds from their garden, small tools for survival, and supplies to keep her alive. The chaos in the country soon reached their home, and Lauren finds herself on the road, walking north, all alone. As she walks, she discovers that others are as lonely and terrified as she is, and she gathers a motley band of people who learn to care for each other and protect each other. She teaches them the new religion she has discovered, and together they establish a community of new growth, which they call Acorn. In a futuristic world where the only constant is change, where water is scarce and the people are terrified, an authoritarian regime is elected, people feel helpless and become isolated. Lauren Olamina's power is in bringing people together in a common vision. They need each other. They are changed by each other. And for them, God is change, the power of change itself. But this also means that God is changeable. God is changed by humanity, not fixed. Nothing is fixed, which means that even in the midst of chaos, nothing is hopeless. All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change. One of the things that I love best about the Unitarian Universalist perspective is that we can find truth in many places, even in science fiction. Because when we read about humanity and all of its hopes and fears, complexities and craziness, we're reading about ourselves. And this helps us to know ourselves and each other in a new way. Stanislavski, the founder of method acting, taught it this way. Acting is living truthfully in an imaginary world. Good fiction is the same thing. It brings out the truth in an imagined situation. And these are the truths which we lift up when we come together to celebrate our lives, our faith, and our community. We are not immutable. All that we touch, we change, and all that we change changes us. Think for a moment of what you have touched in your life. Think of this church, the work that you've done here. Think of the people you have affected by your presence, by your faithfulness, by your generosity. Choir, think of the faces that you see every morning break into smiles when you sing. We are transformed by not only your music, but the energy and love that you share when you sing. Greeters, think of the many people you have helped to feel welcome in this congregation. When you help someone learn how to use our hearing devices, they remain connected to us through the difficulty of hearing loss. We are growing because of your kindness. Soul Matters facilitators, think of the people that you bring together every month to share the intimate workings of their hearts. You are transforming each other. Pastoral associates, think of the people you visit in their homes who cannot get to church. You are helping them be connected to us and you are bringing joy and light into their lives. Parents, think of the children that you brought with you, or the children that you've helped in their education classes. You are helping them to grow in the light of our values of open-hearted acceptance and love. And you are touched by their learning. Last week, we heard of one of our youth who has gotten her whole family to eat a vegetarian diet because of her commitment to the earth and all of earth's creatures. Our classes on healthy sexuality are a part of our commitment to help our children know themselves and learn how to live a healthy lifestyle. This means that the people that they connect with outside of this congregation will also be affected by what we teach. Together, we're trying to shift a culture of shame and dis-ease, which harms so many people. Gardeners, think of the soil that you have turned over together in our interfaith garden, the rich compost which has nourished it, and the sheer volume of healthy veggies that you've brought to the food pantry. What a gift of time and effort. You have transformed the soil and brought forth the fruits of the earth. The people are healthier because of your work, and you are healthier because of your work. All that you touch, you change. And the beauty of this is that all that you change, changes you. We are interconnected through the many pathways we create between us, and we are transformed through our contact with each other. This is what coming to church is all about for me: changing, transforming, growing, seeking. None of us is finished, for we're all, I like to think of us as artistic works in progress. Now, Unitarian Universalists do not hold that people are born inherently sinful, but many of us were raised with that belief, right? It's hard to let go of that early training that what is wrong with us as individuals is because humanity is such a failed creation. But we don't blame our Creator for making garbage, just the opposite. We celebrate our Creator for making humanity such an amazing and wonderful thing. We celebrate our human history for bringing us this far. We strive to understand ourselves and each other, the truth of each other's pain as well as their joy. And we know that we can do better as a people, as a nation, and as a world. We hold out hope for each and every person that we will grow into vital, loving, creative, and caring people, despite our failures, despite our short tempers, despite our dependence on fossil fuels and plastic, despite our addictions to dark chocolate. Oh, wait, maybe that's just me. But we can change because we are an inherently good people. And we can become better people by overcoming our reluctance to change and by believing that our non-conforming lifestyles or our unique twists of humor or any of the things which makes us the individuals that we are is already acceptable, even wonderful. We don't want to judge each other or insist that somebody else change in a way that we would not be willing to do ourselves. Yes, we are born inherently good. And yes, our gender identity or sexual expression is a marker of who we are, and it is good. But there are things, my friends, that we do want to change. Not who we are, but how we are. We want to be better listeners. We want to be more inclusive and patient. We want to be more hospitable. We want to recognize how we participate in a culture of oppression and work to change that by changing ourselves first. So how do we begin? Holly Neer tells us we must start by being open. We must be willing, and that part, my friends, is up to you. For change will not happen to any of us if we are not open and willing. I think most of us began our church attendance whenever we consciously chose to begin attending, because we were looking for something. And as I get to know you, I often ask what brought you to church. And I think the answer I hear most often is the combination of being with people that you care about and working together to do important things. Community tied with action is a winning partnership. What I don't hear as often, at least in large groups like membership classes, is the vulnerability and the sorrow that linger in so many of us. The emotional underbelly which drives us to places of refuge like this sanctuary, For that's what a sanctuary is, after all, a place of safety. We also experience the pull towards the ineffable, the desire to experience something larger than ourselves, the deep-seated need to transform our lives from isolated puddles of confusion and missed opportunity into something better than that. I don't hear about this as often because, not because it's harder to talk about. Not because it's not a reality in our lives. David White wrote, "Sometimes it takes a great sky to find that small, bright, and indescribable wedge of freedom in your own heart." What is important to me is that as a congregation, we create an environment where people can truly be themselves. And through their honesty and vulnerability, people will have an effect on each other. And in that interchange, lives will be transformed, and the ripples will spread out into our community and beyond if we are open and if we are willing. How will the values of Unitarian Universalism be received by people in this country simply because we share them, not only from the pulpit, but in the decisions that we make as individuals because of what you heard? How many people will witness what we choose to do together simply because we're doing it? And how will their lives be transformed because of what they see us do? And how many people will walk into this sanctuary of memory and hope and feel so welcomed, so accepted for who they are and who they truly love, that they will begin to make decisions that are life-affirming instead of self-destructive? Let us be lifted up to the light of change. Because of who you have been, we still are. Because of who you will become, we will be. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for your support for this congregation and your participation in the work that we are called to do. Amen, and blessed be. I'd like to invite Tim Jacoby to come and speak from his heart.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Most of you probably know me as one of the white-haired gentlemen in the choir, standing up here trying to beam, as Rip always encourages us to do. But today I'm here to tell you a little bit about myself, why I'm here today, why I come most every Sunday, and why this place is so important to me. I was raised in a very Catholic family in Ohio, very conservative Catholic schooling throughout 12 years. I was an altar boy, I was a choir boy, I was a soprano back then. I could hit those high notes. And from that, I also, as part of that exercise, I went to a Jesuit high school in Ohio, and that's where I really learned to think for myself. And it's at that time that I started to have some questions about, what is this Catholic thing? And I wasn't sure about it. So after high school and not doing much of anything for about 20 years, or about 10 years during my 20s, 30 plus years ago, we moved to New England and started to look at churches for our children, for ourselves, for myself, and decided that the Catholic thing wasn't going to work. And so I started looking around, and I found the Unitarian Universalists, and I said, wow, what do they believe? And I looked at the principles, I looked at the people, I started talking with people, and I said, this is so consistent with how I see life and how I see myself, you know, the fact that, you know, as a UU, you can believe what you want to believe, and others can believe what they want to believe, even if you don't believe the same thing, and you can have differences, and you don't have a dogma. We don't have a dogma. I found the UU principles are principles by which I want to live my life. This is 30-some years ago. So, been a UU for 30 years. You say, why First Parish in Lexington? Well, 3-plus years ago, I met Priscilla Ryder. She's one of our members. Sits the second row in, usually with her good friend, Cherie. Today, with her friends, Ann and Lydia. And as most of you know, she shuns recognition. She's one of the most gregarious people I know, but she shuns recognition. Well, I'm here to tell you I make up for that. And anyway, so 3 years ago, we met. And yes, things were really, really good. 2+ years ago, I decided that I would begin going to church here in Lexington. Yes, things were and still are that good with Priscilla. And 3 years ago, we were fortunate enough to have Ann bless our wedding, our marriage here in the sanctuary with just our family, our children, our spouses of the children, the grandchildren, and a grandparent. And so, you know, Priscilla is the reason I first started coming here, but that's only part of the reason. She told me stories of the support that she's gotten from this congregation, and I've felt that same support in the 2 years I've been here. Her children have been supported, she's been supported, it's been wonderful. And you know, and as I attend every Sunday, I think about things, and thank you for the wonderful sermon today, the inspiration that she brings, the leadership that she brings, the warmth, and the welcoming. I think that's a big part of it for me. The Imagination Cafe, the Imagination Cafe is the mission writing, other things I like. And of course I have to talk about the choir standing up here in a blue robe today. Rip's incredible leadership, this group of wonderful, accepting friends, and the growth, the diversity of the music, the quality of the music, the sound. And what about those kids today? Jordan? You rock, man. You rock.
Yeah.
But there's other things. Community, some of the community outreach, the Voices on the Green, the climate action efforts that we're undergoing right now, all of those things are so important. And by listing only a few things, all I'm doing is ensuring that I'm missing a number of things that are really important to you. But I really appreciate the warmth and the welcome that I've been given here. And that's why I come every Sunday. But why do I give? All of this thing, the sermons, the choir, the heat, light, all the things that we support, the social action, these things are not inexpensive, right? And something in which you believe that nurtures you and your children is something that you support. My dad used to say, you only get out of something what it is you put into it. And I've lived by that rule my entire life, and that's partly why Priscilla and I give here and why we are so active in the community here at First Parish. So when Larry asked us to, suggested that we ask about the basis for our contribution to your neighbor today during the greeting session, I asked Don, and Don said, to give back. I'm here to give back. And that struck me. I said, yeah, that's a very good reason. So I'm asking you to think about giving back as you consider your contribution helping to support this church and our efforts here at First Parish. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. We'll now receive the morning's offerings for the life and work of the church.
Thank you.
With gratitude for their service, I now invite this year's stewardship team to come forward. Would you please join me and thank them for their hard work this year?
Please rise as you are able and join us in a litany of celebration written for this occasion by the Reverend Anne and inspired by the six sources which guide our faith. The audience, your response will be, we are called to love, seek, and serve.
Music, mystery, and wonder renew our spirits and move us to open up to life itself.
We are called to love, seek, and serve.
Prophetic women and men challenge us to confront structures of evil with justice, compassion, and the transforming power of love.
We are called to love, seek, and serve.
Our ethical and spiritual life is inspired by religions of the world. We are open to the truths found in all cultures and all traditions.
We are called to love, seek, and serve.
In a world beset by polarizing differences, we do not turn away. We open our hearts and seek a way to love our neighbors as ourselves.
We are called to love, seek, and serve.
In the face of challenges to our planet and to our democracy, we seek truth in the paths of science and reason.
We are called to love, seek, and serve.
We are a part of the sacred circle of life, embracing all creatures as we strive to live in harmony with the rhythms of nature.
We are called to love, seek, and serve. Now, would you please come forward during the final hymn and bring your pledge cards? If you've already pledged, you can bring this pink slip. Please join us in singing, Come Go With Me. Whoops, excuse me, Come and Go With Me. Not the song from the 60s. Please come and go with me to the land where I'm bound.
Thank you.
now sing the chalice closing hymn.
And now, in joyful celebration of all that we are and all that will become, we lift our hearts in gratitude for this congregation gathered on the Lexington Green. May our dreams come to fruition as we spread the message of our liberating faith. And let us go forth from this place, knowing that we carry the love of this community to all whom we serve. May the warmth of our connection sustain us until we meet again. Amen.